بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Hello everyone, this is Dr. Nadine Burhan. It's my pleasure today to explore with you Creutzfeldt-Jakob or Jakob disease, commonly known as CJD disease. This is actually a rare and fatal neurodegenerative disorder present with a unique significant challenges to medical and scientific committee. Inshallah, through this presentation, we will understand the basic concept of this infectious disease, and we will discuss the critical aspects of its infection prevention and control measures. The presentation today will be, inshallah, both in Arabic and English, and we will try to answer all your questions, if any, at the end of the presentation. Kindly don't forget to register your attendance at the link posted in the chat. Thank you for your attention, and let's begin. I hope that slide is obvious for and clear for every one. I'll try just to make it end the presentation. Okay, an introduction. Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease is one of several neurologically degenerative diseases caused by a group of protein particles that are infectious by nature with their ability to replicate in central nervous system and interrupt the crucial neuron function. إذن مرضنا اليوم أو المرض اللي راح نتكلم عنه اليوم اللي هو Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease يتميز بأنه أحد أخطر الأمراض اللي تصيب الجهاز العصبي، خاصة الجهاز العصبي المركزي، وذلك نتيجة إصابة هذا الجهاز ببعض البروتينات اللي تعرف باسم البريونز. Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease were originally called a slow virus. في بداية ظهور أو نشوء المرض، اعتقد العلماء أنه المرض نتيجة إصابة المريض بسلو فيروس أو فيروس بطيء، ويمكن سمي بهذا الاسم نتيجة البرولونج انكيبيشن بيريد أو طول فترة الحضانة اللي قد تمتد إلى أكثر من 10 سنوات. في بدايات أو ثمانينات القرن الماضي it was proposed that the etiology of this neurodegenerative disease was not a viral in nature, لكن هي كانت نتيجة الإصابة بانفكشوس بروتين بارتكل أو أجزاء من البروتين تصيب الجهاز العصبي المركزي اللي تعنى أو تعرف باسم البريونز. As a background, يمكن في بداية العشرينات في العام الماضي Creutzfeldt وجيكوب وهم عالمان ألمانيان أو نيورو باثولوجيست جيرمان نيورو باثولوجيست they describe أو لاحظوا إنه وجود unusual neurological degeneration leading to a rapid central nervous system collapse وفي بعض الأحيان حدوث الوفاة بشكل سريع. يمكن لاحظوا خلال الأوتوبسي أو التشريح ما بعد الوفاة في عينات أو أنسجة البيشنت خاصة أنسجة الدماغ they notice a little tissue inflammation مصاحب لي extensive loss of normal brain tissue and replacement of a glial cell giving the brain a star-like or a spongy or spongy form appearance مشابه لشكل الإسفنج نتيجة للدستركشن السريع في أنسجة الجهاز العصبي. عشان كذا يمكن في بعض الأحيان يشار إلى البرايون ديزيز أو الجيكوب ديزيز as a transmissible spongy form encephalopathies. طيب أهم الكي كونسبت اللي بإذن الله نأمل إنه تنتهي أو ينتهي يومنا اليوم والجميع يمكن ثابت في أذهنته هذه المفاهيم إنه البريون بروتين آر synthesized normally in a brain tissue. يوجد في أنسجة الدماغ لدينا بشكل طبيعي ونورمال البريونز، لكن البريون ديزيز أوكيرز في عدة أنماط أو من different types، بداية من sporadic form to familial transmissible or gene mutation form، أو النوع اللي يمكن إحنا نعنى به أكثر في الأوساط الصحية اللي هو الإياثروجينيك form، واللي نحاول قدر الإمكان to prevent its occurrence inside healthcare facilities. Prions are highly resistant to routine sterilization and disinfection method. يمكن راح نستعرض هذا المفهوم لاحقا. Prion eradication evolves chemical or increased temperature extended cycle of sterilization. وفي بعض الأحيان combination of both. The healthcare provider should be educated on prion disease to recognize the risk factor. We apply all the needed infection control measures in different units. طيب. يمكن مفهوم البريونز شوية صعب إنه إحنا نستوعب إنه هو موجود بصورة طبيعية في أنسجتنا، خاصة الـ CNS تشو. يمكن هذه مقالة في الإنسايكلوبيديا of Cell Biology about البريون وضحت إنه the cellular form of the prion protein in normal cellular form is PR. PC has about 90% sequence similarity across all mammals. هي توجد تقريبا في كل الماملز بسيكونس مشابه. And it's expressed in almost all tissue. توجد تقريبا في كل الأنسجة. But with the highest level are found in the central nervous system أو في الجهاز العصبي المركزي. توجد بشكل أكبر. بالغالب تتواجد الـ PRPC في السينابس أو السينابتيك ميمبرين ما بين النهايات العصبية. And the function of الـ PRPC يمكن ما هي واضحة أو غير واضحة للباحثين بشكل دقيق حتى الآن، لكنها تتواجد في عدة نظائر أو أيزوفورم، ويمكن من هنا يكمن الخطر في الإصابة بالبريون ديزيز. إذا تواجد البريون في أنسجة الجهاز العصبي في شكل أو تركيبة الـ PRPSC، يمكن هنا تكمن الخطر، لأنه تواجد البريون من صورته الطبيعية PRPC إلى PRPSC يؤدي إلى misfolding of normal بريون، وبهذا الشكل leading to accumulation أو تراكم في الـ misfolded protein في الأنسجة، وبالتالي subsequent damage of the nervous system. يمكن لزيادة الاستيعاب لمفهوم البريون وكيف ممكن أن تؤثر النظائر أو الأيزوفورم على الجهاز العصبي، يمكن هذا فيديو بسيط في اليوتيوب، أدعو الجميع to scan this QR code for more understanding of this process. طيب، يمكن انتقلنا إلى وانتهينا من الانترودكشن الباكراوند أو البيزكس concept of this disease and how it happens and what are the consequences of misfolded protein. يمكن ينتج عن هذا الـ misfolding different types of Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. يمكن مثل ما ذكرنا في البداية في الـ key concept إنه يتواجد أو قد يظهر أو يطرأ المرض على الأشخاص بصورة sporadic أو بصورة منفصلة without any epidemiological لينك بنسبة قد تتجاوز الـ 95%. أيضا يتواجد in a different form اللي هو الـ familial type due to genetic mutation. أحيانا في بعض العائلات يوجد genetic mutation، فبالتالي يكون كل النشأ معرض إلى misfolding of this kind protein، وبالتالي يكون عرضة أكثر لظهور الـ Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. يمكن النوع الأقل لكن هو اللي نخشى منه في الرعاية الصحية هو الآياتروجينيك. Also can be occurred caused by introduction of prion laden tissue, سواء كان بالtransplanted or extracted form of disease individual من البرين ولا CNS tissue, أو حتى contamination of medical or specially neurosurgical instrument during invasive procedure. طيب كيف ممكن ينتقل الiatrogenic CGD disease داخل المنشآت الصحية؟ يمكن أشهر الأمثلة هي التشو transplantation, سواء كانت الdura mater أو البيريكارديوم أو الكورنيا, بالغالب النيورولوجيكال تشو. أحياناً أيضاً نتيجة لحقن البيتويتري هرمونز أو البيتويتري هرمون preparation زي الجروث هرمون والجونادوتروبين, أحياناً إذا تم جمعها وحقنها من شخص مصاب إلى شخص آخر أيضا قد يصاب بالCGD disease. Contaminated surgical equipment or implementation of electrodes deep in the brain tissue of affected patient used in another one can also transmit the disease. أعتقد our awareness about these possible method of transmission of CGD disease could also help us to control and prevent further transmission. طيب diagnosis ايضا مهم, خاصه انه كل الادوات او الاجراءات المصاحبه للdiagnosis قد تكون ايضا possible station of transmitting this infection. Usually a definitive diagnosis of CGD is made by direct examination of the brain tissue, وبالتالي أيضا وجود destructive change اللي ذكرناها سابقا أو spongy form appearance. طيب يمكن في الانفكشن كنترول يهمنا جدا mode of transmission, لأنه بمعرفة mode of transmission أو آلية أو كيفية انتقال المرض قد يساعدنا أكثر في الحد من انتشاره. خلال صراحة مراجعة أغلب الغايدلاينز من مختلف الدول, يمكن أغلبها stated أنه most common cases of CGD is sporadic, it's very rare to be reported انه ال CGD transported or transmit during or within a healthcare facility. However, a healthcare worker should be aware of potential risk of transmission from patient to patient او حتى patient to healthcare worker, and how they should deal with all the contaminated equipment and services. Also, all the published data showed that there is no epidemiological evidence that indicates that healthcare worker at increased occupational risk of CGD, and there is no epidemiological evidence that CGD can be transmitted through normal social contact, either mother to mother or by blood product. يعني يمكن هذا الجانب شوية مطمئن للتعامل مع مرضى المصابين بالجيكوب ديزيز. Aidan, another statement said that prion disease are not spread in person among person to person, and in general, patient with prion disease can be cared for by healthcare professional and family members without risk of transmission of infectious particle. Lakin again, with the consideration in the iatrogenic cases could also happen نتيجة التعرض لأنسجة الدماغ المصابة وحتى البدي product أو الفلويد أيضا المعرضة لتواجد البريونز. Contaminated surgical equipment or electrode in the brain also have transmitted infections prion from one to another مثل ما ذكرنا. So in this instance, standard sterilization and disinfection method have been inadequate. يمكن التعامل سواء كان في التنظيف والتطهير أو حتى التعقيم مع الأدوات الجراحية اللي تستخدم الملوثة اللي تستخدم على المريض واستخدام الأنماط الطبيعية أو النورمال بروتوكول هو غير كافي وغير فعال للتخلص من البريون. إذن الميجور انفكشن كنترول كونسيدريشن in dealing with patients with the CGD, it is very important that the patients who are known or suspected to have prion disease are identified before any surgical procedure involving tissue that may be infectious. حتى في الـ guidelines تعريف الـ patient أو الـ high risk patient with the CGD هو any known or suspected patient to have a prion. إذن لاحقا في الـ presentation when we are referring to high risk patient we mean any known or suspected patient. Instrument use in these cases will require a special كيف يتم التعامل من ناحية الانفكشن كنترول في أي خطوات special reprocessing environmental cleaning and disinfection in surgery and laboratory لأنه هذه اليونت يمكن هي اللي يكون فيها فرصة أكثر أو للتعرض لأنسجة الدماغ will require procedure that will inactivate prions and of course آلية التعامل أو disposal of contaminated waste. طيب what are the method for inactivation of Creutzfeldt Jakob or Jacob agent? كيف يتم التعامل مع الأدوات الملوثة? Prion disease such as CGD represent a unique infection prevention problem because دائما البريونز ديزيز exhibit unusual resistance to convention conventional chemical and physical decontamination method. ويمكن من هنا جاءت الفكرة للإنفكشن كنترول إنه لا يمكن أو غير كافي التعامل معها بالconventional أو النورمال بروتوكول لأنه بالغالب نواجه unusual resistance وبالتالي أيضا الآلية المثلى أو الideal method of inactivation of CGD disease حتى في الأوساط العلمية ظلت controversial. طيب يمكن أيضا من الطرائف العلمية اللي نشرت في إحدى الجامعات تحديدا جامعة يوتا in their genetic page they made like an experiment and they call it we cannot kill what is not alive. The experiment showed that the prion cannot be destroyed by boiling alcohol, acid or standard autoclaving method, or even with radiation. In fact, an infected brain that have been sitting in formaldehyde for decades can still transmit a spongiform disease, so it's very resistance, and they mentioned that cooking your burger till it's well done won't destroy the prion. ويمكن هذا يشير إلى صعوبة التخلص من البريون في الظروف الطبيعية للcleaning and disinfection. طيب what is or are the allowed disinfectant to be used? طيب إحنا الآن بعد التعرض ل أو التعامل مع حالات للCGD disease بطبيعة الحال لابد أن نكون على وعي تام في الانفكشن كنترول بآلية تطهير الأسطح وأيضا التعامل مع الأدوات الجراحية. طيب أيضا في الانترناشنال guidelines I found this interesting table صراحة with this huge list of ineffective or unreliable method to eliminate or inactivate CGD disease. وفقط they mentioned four chemicals that can reduce the titer of infectious unit by greater than four logs. They mentioned chlorine, phenol, gonadine thiocyanate, and the sodium hydroxide. يمكن في أغلب المنشآت الصحية الكلورين يتواجد وهذا شيء جيد. إذن again في environmental surface cleaning and disinfection for non-critical contaminated with high risk tissue like laboratory surface contaminated with brain or brain tissue should be cleaned and then spot decontaminated with 1 to 10 dilution of sodium hypochlorite or what you call bleach for a contact time at least 15 minute, and to minimize the environmental contamination, disposable cover sheets could be used on working surface. What about high infectivity or low infectivity tissue for critical and semi-critical items? In the WHO, in their manual, they list or tabulate the infectivity category into three categories: high infectivity tissue, غالباً في brain tissue, spinal cord and eye; low infectivity, CSF, kidney, liver, lung, lymph node, and placenta; and no detectable infectivity في other tissue like adrenal and adipose tissue. ممكن في كل نوع من أنواع هذه الأنسجة آلية مختلفة أو recommendation مختلف للتعامل. طيب ذكرنا آلية التعامل of environmental cleaning and disinfection. What about sterilization? يمكن ذكرناها في الكي كونسبت في البداية، إنه لابد على الانفكشن كنترول يونت وأيضا كافة الهيلث كير وركرز إنهم يعوا إنه التعامل أو sterilization of any instrument used on a patient, either high-risk patient, either with a confirmed or suspected case of CGD, لابد أن يكون مختلف. Again, the highly infectious materials like brain, spinal cord, and eyes, low infectivity like CSF والكدني. In contrast with the routine hospital protocol, no pre-cleaning procedure. بالغالب احنا في الحالات الاخرى عند التعامل مع الانسترومنت we start a pre-cleaning procedure either with enzymatic or detergent just to help or encourage the beginning of cleaning then sterilization process. لكن with positive cases of CGD, there is no pre-cleaning were done. Conventional sterilization methods are not acceptable for critical and semi-critical items that have contact with a high risk tissue, and they must be reprocessed in a manner to ensure that elimination of prions or either disposable. Or disposal. يمكن حتى لاحقا خلال البرزنتيشن a lot of recommendation toward either using of high temperature for a long time أو حتى disposable or incineration. طيب guidelines of reprocessing medical devices potentially or for potentially contaminated items with the Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, they divide the items into two categories, either high risk tissue for a high risk patient or a low risk tissue with a high risk patient. في البداية low risk tissue with a high risk patient, we will deal with the instrument in a conventional protocol. These devices can be cleaned and either disinfected or sterilized by means of conventional protocol of heat أو حتى chemical sterilization. طبعاً or by means of high level disinfection. الاندوسكوب أيضاً يتم التعامل معها with the standard cleaning and high level disinfection will be adequate for reprocessing purposes except a neurosurgical endoscope لأنها very invasive in contact with a high risk tissue. While في environmental surfaces مثل ما ذكرنا standard disinfection followed by a spot disinfection. أيضا to minimize the environmental contamination, the cover or cover sheet is recommended or can be used. What about the high risk tissue for high risk patient? يمكن هنا التحدي الأكبر. Devices that are constructed so that cleaning procedure result in effective tissue removal, like surgical instrument, can be cleaned and sterilized by very high temperature, تصل إلى من 121 up to 132 degrees centigrade for 1 hour or 60 minutes in gravity, and up to 134 degrees centigrade for 18 minutes in pre-vacuum. تعتبر reasonable on the basis of scientific literature. This method should be or should result in the decrease greater than 5 logs. بالإضافة إلى adequate cleaning of this instrument أيضا could give an additional 4 logs reduction. ويمكن هذا الـ requirement or recommended or reasonable basics of scientific disinfection or sterilization. For cleaning, place the contaminated items in a container filled with liquid like saline, water, or phenolic solution to re-trade the adherence of organic material to the medical devices. احنا يمكن ذكرنا انه الـ pre-cleaning is not recommended, لكن recommended to keep the item or the instrument moist before the actual reprocessing as possible. And this will remove any liquid, and after that you should remove any liquids before continuing the next step, which is an initial decontamination, مثل ما ذكرنا, لدرجات حرارة عالية لمدة طويلة تصل إلى الساعة. Then this should be followed by terminal cleaning, wrapping, and sterilization can be done by a conventional method. Again, devices that cannot be cleaned or treated or that are too difficult to be treated or cleaned should not be or should be discarded. لأنه بعض الانسترومنت يمكن ما تتحمل درجات الحرارة العالية ولا حتى يمكن الكيميكالز أو السوكينج in chemicals for an hour تقريبا. إذا في هذه الحالة يتم discard أو التخلص من هذه ال instrument for safety purpose, لأنه we cannot ensure proper sterilization. To minimize the drying of tissue and body fluid on the object, مثل ما ذكرنا, keep the instrument moist until cleaned and decontaminated. بعض أنماط sterilization أيضا غير مقبولة, مثل flash sterilization should not be used for reprocessing of any instrument, especially instrument contaminated with the CGD. Items that permit only low temperature should be discarded, مثل ما ذكرنا, and contaminated items that are not processed according to these recommendations. وبعد كده تم اكتشاف إنه الحالة مصابة بال CGD should be recalled and appropriate reprocess should be done. Equipment that requires special prion reprocess should be identified after use for ease of cleaning to minimize percutaneous injury and generation of aerosol, لأنه بالتالي ممكن تزيد the possibility of cross-contamination أو أيضا حتى the contamination of the surfaces. Use of non-powered instrument طبعا as much as possible, ولو أنه في أغلب حالات النيوروسيرجري they will use the drill and saws, or ensure that disposable protective equipment cover all available powered instrument, أو على الأقل ضمان تغطية كافة الأدوات اللي قد تصدر aerosol بشكل جيد لضمان عدم تلوثها أو تقليل تلوث الأسطح as possible. Other steam sterilization cycle لدرجات حرارة 132 إلى في مدة قصيرة زي 15 دقيقة have been shown to be only partially effective, so it's not recommended. We أيضا استخدام ال sterilization process to reduce the prion log either for gaseous or physical زي dry heat, it's unacceptable. وفقط يتم الاعتماد على الاوتوكليفينج لدرجات حرارة مرتفعة لمدة طويلة فقط. طيب قد نتصور أن الحالات جدا نادرة, لكن يمكن this published chart in the CDC page showing the Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease death and age-adjusted death rate in the United States since 1979 لحد 2020, it showed that the number of deaths مرتفعة وقد تتجاوز ال 500 حالة في السنة. إذن أعتقد وجود written policy للCJD disease والوعي وأيضاً التدريب على آلية التعامل مع مثل هذه الحالات سواء كانت حالات مشتبهة أو مؤكدة هي ضرورة في الأوساط الطبية وفي العالم. للأسف يمكن الأدلة العلمية على المستوى الإقليمي يمكن تفتقر كثير آلية التعامل مع CJD أو حتى Infection Control Guidelines in CJD. However, there is some published guidelines like Australian guidelines and Canadian guidelines, لكن جميعها أيضا يمكن تفتقر إلى التفاصيل. أيضاً في بعض الكتب Special Clinical Infectious Disease there is a page or an article about a recommendation for disinfection and sterilization dealing with the Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. يمكن أقدم الغايدلاينز اللي أنا وجدتها خلال البحث كان صادر من الـ WHO في 1999 أو 2000. ممكن يتطرق إلى بعض الـ consideration in special area ولا يختلف كثير يمكن عن الـ guidelines أو recommendation العالمية الأخرى. طيب يمكن ذكر آلية التعامل أو الـ patient care for patient in home and healthcare setting. ذكر المانوال أن الـ private room or in a nursing care is not required for infection control purposes for those patients with CJD. However, ذكر أيضا المانوال أنه النتيجة يمكن للحالة الصحية progressive degenerative issue وممكن تتحول إلى critical care, قد يحتاج patient إلى نقله إلى المنشأة أو إلى المستشفيات بصورة سريعة لتلقي الرعاية الطبية. However, there's recommendation of a special isolation precaution. Patient waste should be handled according to the country or regional or federal regulation. يمكن احنا في المملكة نعتبرها as infectious biohazard waste ونتعامل معها بهذه الطريقة. Contamination by body fluid ايضا showing no greater hazard more than any other patient, and there is no special precaution are required for either feeding ولا feeding tube ولا suctioning tube ولا حتى dealing with bed linens. طيب الدنتال بروسيجر يمكن ايضا مهم انه احنا نذكره اليوم, خاصة انه في بعض الحالات يتم التعامل مع ازالة العصب في الدنتال بروسيجر. Although in the epidemiological investigation has not revealed any evidence that a dental procedure lead to increased risk of iatrogenic transmission of transmissible spongiform encephalopathies or CJD disease among human. However, an experimental study showed that there could be a risk of contamination or transmission when dealing with root canal. And the guidelines and the WHO guideline stated a table with three main recommendations. They call it an optional precaution for major dental work. في البداية, use a single-use item and equipment as possible. For reusable dental items we should destroy after use or حتى decontaminate بالطريقة اللي ذكرناها سابقا, and schedule any high risk patient either suspected or confirmed at the end of the day with the proper extensive terminal cleaning and disinfection of a dental unit and the clinic after that. طيب surgical procedure also could exhibit a very huge risk of transmission, especially if urological tissue is involved. And before admission to the hospital or to the healthcare facility, infection control department should be aware and informed about the entrance of this patient and the possibility of performing any surgical procedure. Every effort should be made to plan carefully all the procedure that the patient could have, especially what are the instruments that could handle the patient during that could be handled during the surgery, the way of storage, cleaning, decontamination, and disposal. And of course, that should be in a written protocol, and this is very essential. So أعتقد أهم التوصيات اللي لابد نأخذها يمكن من المحاضرة اليوم إنه لابد أن يكون في written protocol about dealing with prion patient with prion disease or a CGD disease, especially in hospital with this scope of service of or neurosurgical service. طيب. Also, the staff should be aware about this procedure, لأنهم قد يضطروا إلى تحضير بعض الأدوات such as a single use item before the procedure. Also, this patient should be scheduled at the end of operating list. Staff also should be adhere to protocol that identifies specific or specifics regarding pre-operative, peri, and post-operative management, how they will deal with the patient, how they will dispose the material, and also how they will deal with the reusable material. If there is any suspected laboratory specimen, also the lab staff should be aware and trained about how they will deal, clean, disinfect with these kind of specimen. And there is also another recommendation. If the patient scheduled for any outside or outside the bedside procedure, if possible, they may perform this procedure at a bedside, of course, with the consideration that ensure the ease of environmental decontamination and, of course, preventing any spillage that could occur. Also, WHO recommendation stated an 8 recommendation with the percutaneous or precaution for surgical procedure. If the patient will perform any procedure in operating theater, minimum required number of healthcare personnel should be inside the room just to minimize the risk of infection. A full single use equipment or PPE should be done by healthcare worker, started from water resistance theater gown with plastic apron, gloves, mask, goggles, and the patient should be covered very well. Mask all non-disposable equipment or cover all non-disposable equipment to minimize environmental contamination. Also, they should maintain a one-way flow of instrument to minimize the traffic inside the OR and decrease the possibility of cross-contamination. All protective clothing and covered and liquid and so solid waste should be labeled and incineration is preferred. All hazard should be, or samples should be labeled as a biohazard with a biohazard label. All the surfaces should be cleaned according to the recommendation that we mentioned before. What about the anesthesia? For general anesthesia, CGD disease not transmissible by respiratory route. However, this destruction by incineration of non-reusable equipment is recommended in this case. For local anesthesia, needles should not be reused, in particular if the needle contacted the CSF, and it should be discarded and also destroyed to minimize any risk of contamination. For post-exposure management, if لا قدر الله exposure happened to healthcare worker, I think there is no يعني special consideration in dealing with the post-exposure protocol for healthcare worker started either if it is percutaneous or mucocutaneous contamination of unbroken skin with any body fluid. They should start with washing and washing with the detergent and abundant quantity of warm water. Avoid scrubbing, rinse and dry, and they could maximize the safety by applying a 1 to 10 dilution of bleach to the site of percutaneous injury or needle stick injury. Needle stick or laceration gently encouraged bleeding, wash and avoid scrubbing with and with warm soapy water, rinse again, dry and cover, and further treatment or suturing according to the case. And if any incidental splashes yeah, encountered the eyes or the mouth, so splashes or irrigation with the saline or tap water is recommended. And this is a very interesting information. The health and safety guidelines mandate reporting of injury, and the record should be kept for no less than 20 years. وأعتقد this is نتيجة الـ very long incubation period of the disease اللي مثل ما ذكرنا قد تزيد عن 10 إلى 12 عام. So I think the occupational health consideration inside the healthcare facility should take this in consideration. Laboratory أيضا مثل ما ذكرنا في البداية أحد أهم risky units when dealing with specimen of CGD patient. Again, there is general protective measures. يعني يمكن أغلبها يتوافق مع توصيات الـ infection control لـ all other diseases مثل منع الـ eating والdrinking والsmoking in the laboratory. However, the laboratory coverall وgowns and uniform لابد أنها تستخدم عند التعامل مع هذه العينات. أيضا الـ safety glasses والـ face shield to prevent or protect from the splashes. Gloves also should be used. All gowns and gloves and face shield should be discarded or destroyed according to the recommendation or incinerated whenever possible to avoid or minimize the use of sharp during handling the specimen. All technical procedures should be performed in a way to minimize aerosol, as we mentioned before, and the droplet, just to prevent further possibility of infection. And work surfaces also should be decontaminated, as mentioned. And all contaminated materials should be either incinerated or decontaminated with the mentioned method. And all laboratory supervisor should ensure that adequate training in laboratory safety is obtained or provided for their staff and how they will be able to deal with these kinds of specimen. Also surgical pathology, لأنها يمكن أغلب أو أكثر الأماكن اللي قد يكون فيها direct contact with this tissue, precaution should be taken when handling a different tissue specimen, especially neurological or brain tissue specimen. And also, I found a very also interesting statement that WHO does not recommend a brain biopsy for diagnosis of CGD. They just recommend observation of changes within the brain tissue just to minimize risk of infection. There is also a table that shows the precaution for working with high and low infectivity tissue from patients with known or suspected prion disease. They recommend, if possible, or whenever possible, أن يتم تحديد labs محددة للتعامل مع هذا النوع من العينات إذا كان بالإمكان لضمان تقليل فرصة انتقال العدوى إلى أشخاص أكثر. وكل الـ sample should be labeled with the biohazard label. Use single use protective equipment and protective clothes. يمكن اللي ذكرناها سابقا. Use disposable equipment whenever possible. كل generated waste should be also incinerated. Fixation and waste flow fluid also should be disposed by incineration. And also for labs that handling a large number of sample, لازم يتخذوا احتياطات أشد يعني تشدد أو أكثر ضراوة لمنع فرصة انتقال العدوى داخل المنشأة. طيب. Also, we shouldn't miss the post-mortem examination or post-mortem possibility of transmission of this kind of infection. Post-mortem examination remains an essential element in confirming the clinical diagnosis and cause of death by prion disease. Ideally, three people should be present during the examination post-mortem, سواء كان pathologist أو assistant technician and further person to handle specimen. The observer should be prohibited or kept minimum during the procedure, except if there is any additional one for training purposes. All personnel should be made aware for the relevant history of the patient and fully informed about the procedure and infection control measures in dealing with a positive or suspected cases. Thank you so much for being with us for almost 1 hour, knowing the basics of infection of CGD diseases and the principle of infection control dealing with this kind of disease.